Today on Community Connections, we're going to talk about the history of Long Branch and the two organizations who are preserving it and help educating us. I have with me Beth Duze Woolley, and you are the historical association.
Yes.
You're the educator of the group.
Yes.
And Jim Foley, who in his real day job is an educator, but you are the, for the Church of the, I'm leaving a blank in there, the Church of the Seven Presidents.
Church of the Presidents Museum.
Museum.
Right. Yeah.
You're the head of the Board of Trustees?
Correct.
Two different groups. There's so much history to go around in Long Branch that you're able to share and work together. Would that be accurate?
Yeah. There's enough to go around. He's also, they're trying to restore a building, which is a huge amount of work, and separate from what we do, which is just trying to educate people about Long Branch history and point out different parts of Long Branch history.
And how do you do that?
We have six programs a year that we offer free. Anybody can come.
You did one about sports, so I showed up.
Yes, you did. You finally showed up. It was great. And we're having one on Wednesday about St. Catherine Drexel. Eugene Soma's coming to give that talk.
And so by the time the show airs, that will probably
That'll be gone.
But that's about a woman who had, she lived in Long Branch for a period of time and later became
an American. She's a saint. Yeah. And summered in
literally,
Long Branch.
Not figuratively.
No, she's an American saint. Yes, she's a Catholic saint. And in March, we have a man who's been writing a blog about the Harbor Mansions, which is our first condominium on the ocean front in Long Branch. Mm-hmm. And the blog runs everything from wealthy German Jewish financiers, you know, during the Civil War time, and runs all the way up to current day and includes, you know, everyone. I mean, mafia, a TV star. I mean, you can't believe what's involved just from one building.
Who writes? Who's
his name is Charlie Bruns, B-R-U-N-S.
And he lives in Long Branch currently or grew up here, or you're not sure?
I'm not sure.
You've met him, though?
Oh, yeah, yes.
And how can somebody find his blog?
He publishes it a lot of times on Facebook. Ed Thomas has the Long Branch, Historic Long Branch Facebook page. Mm-hmm. And there's also CJ Rubin has a Hometown Long Branch page. And Charlie Bruns will publish the blog. If you Google Harbor Mansions, it'll come up. It's his blog and it runs. And he's now he's done eight different chapter installments. That's it.
So it's not just about the building that's currently there that is, I don't know, about 50, 60 years old.
Yeah, no, all the way going back on the property. And then it also stretches into West End and next door, the Harbor Island Spa. And
the Hobart Harbor Island Villa. Well, Harbor Island Villa is what was built. The Harbor Island Spa. Is what was there for, well, it was knocked down about 20 years ago now.
Yeah.
But that building had its own illustrious history.
History, right. Yeah, it's good. It's good. It's, you know, it's typical Long Branch kind of mafia story. It's good.
So you've got that. Who else do you have coming to speak?
Okay. And then in April, we're doing what we call a road trip tour, and we're going over to the West End School. And as you know, Dr. Barabas and the NJ Rep just bought the West End School. Mm-hmm. And they're making a whole performing arts center there. And he's taking us on a tour so we can view the school and tell us his vision. And we might scout out a little closet space over there for us, too. And then we don't usually do two road trip tours, but we are this spring because we're going to take a road trip tour over to Ocean Township to the Eden Woolley House, because they're having an exhibit really on Long Branch presidents, which is kind of where almost Jim comes in. They have all the artifacts currently from Church of the Presidents on display in a great exhibit over there on Presidents at the Jersey Shore.
So that's the building that's over by their public library.
Yes.
And that's on Deal Road.
Yes.
And that's we're taping this late November.
Okay.
So anybody could go there now. That
yes.
exhibit's going to be there for a while.
Yeah, and I totally encourage everybody to go over there.
And those are items, artifacts on loan from you guys.
From the museum, right.
What do they have over there?
Oh, it's not just the seven presidents that vacationed at Long Branch, but there were others, like President Nixon came to Seagirt and John F. Kennedy and those presidents. But from the Long Branch Church of the Presidents Museum, we have President Grant's game table and a wicker chair from his oceanfront cottage right next to Stella Maris. We have the desk of President Woodrow Wilson's summer office in Asbury Park, that's on exhibit. The flag that was draped over President Garfield's coffin, as you know, he died mm-hmm. here in the Elbron section of Long Branch. And it's some pretty amazing artifacts. And the exhibit is open now through June of 2017, so people have an opportunity to go see these items.
One of the things we always heard, Ned, was that those artifacts and the exhibits and the things that were in the old church, they were hard to hold together. It was hard to keep them in one spot for a while. You know, the building got very dilapidated until Mrs. Dinkelspiel got more involved in the late 90s.
Yes, actually, in I think it was 2000, the building itself was listed on New Jersey's top 10 list of most endangered historic structures in New Jersey.
It was about to fall down.
It was about to fall down. As a matter of fact, Guy Hembling, who's been involved with the restoration of the project mm-hmm. Since 1999, he brought in a group of people from the Monmouth County Historic Association.
I remember that,
to try to partner with us. And they were scared to death while in the building. I mean, they couldn't wait to get out of the building. They were afraid that it was going to collapse.
Well, the foundation was failing, and the size
yes.
of the buildings were not in good shape.
No, they weren't.
When did you get involved? Let me ask you that first.
Florence Dinkelspiel, who was president of the museum after her husband died, asked me to join the board in 1998. Right after he had died. She had reorganized the board and got some young bloods in there, and Dr. Fernicola from Allenhurst, and Marie Sylvester from Interlaken, and Beth was also on the board. And we really started working on preserving the building, but doing it properly.
What had to be done first? Because my memory is it had to be braced or it was going to fall. It was that close.
Yeah. Basically, everything had to be done. The first thing that was done is the entire interior of the building was stripped and gutted because we found out that the actual foundation was just built right at ground level, that they mm-hmm. didn't dig down, they didn't have footings or anything like that. So after we gutted the building, then we had to actually lay a concrete, steel reinforced concrete mat inside the building. Put steel L brackets to support the massive tower to the building and the sides. So currently, the entire building is supported by cement and steel. The
exterior, now it's stable.
Now it's stable. Yes. That was the first thing that we had to do was stabilize the building so it didn't fall down. From there, we just slowly and surely, painstakingly, one project at a time, from you know, a new roof to new leaders and gutters to repairing the tower. Just last winter, we reinstalled the eight windows to the tower for the first time since 1997 when they were removed and put into storage. We're right now where the entire exterior of the building is restored. And now we have to work on the windows, the doors, and then the interior of the building.
Exterior is just about done. The paint job matches one of the original pictures?
No, we're really lucky that we have a place here in town called Sipperstein's Paint, because the entire Katz family has been amazing. And they have donated every drop, every ounce of paint that's gone into this building. But in addition to the paint, they also took some of the shingles and examined them. So these are the original colors from the 1879.
Not almost the original colors.
No, the exact same colors.
They did analysis right down to the original paint.
They analyzed the wood shingles and the trim and all that. So it's amazing.
Now, is the little cottage from the Garfield train tracks, is that on site?
Yes. The Garfield.
Either one of you tell that story.
Well, I've been talking a lot. You want to talk, Beth? As President Garfield was attempted to be assassinated on July 2nd, 1881.
In D.C.
In Washington, D.C., at the train station. He lingered all summer long in Washington at the White House in hopes of recovery. The entire nation followed his movements. It was finally decided in early September that his best chances of recovery would be to come right here to Long Branch and come to the Elbron Oceanfront Cottage. So that was done. They had to build basically an eighth of a mile spur from the railroad station at Elbron right to the front porch of the cottage.
Overnight.
Well, they started after 6 p.m. On September 5th. And it was ready before 1 o'clock, September 6th. It's amazing that they could, you know, do that quickly. So President Garfield was brought to Elbron. Unfortunately, he died September 19th, 1881, right there. They had a quick little memorial service, and that's the flag that's on exhibit at Ocean Township Museum currently. Who were some popular actors today, like Tom Cruise or Leonardo DiCaprio, whatever. The most famous actor at the time, Oliver Byron, bought some of the railroad ties down Lincoln Avenue and built the little tea hut that he had on his property, which ultimately was after all the family members had passed on. He gave it back to the actual builder, the Long Branch guy who built it from the Presley family.
Oh, okay.
And I know there's a lot of viewers who will well remember the Presleys. So it was moved to the Presleys' property in North Long Branch. And then when they moved, they decided to give it to the Church of the President.
So when was that?
I'm not exactly sure, but I think it was in the mid-80s.
Okay.
That it was donated to the museum.
Now, the building, I was in there once or twice when Mr. Dinkelspiel was still alive. He gave me the tour. Mm-hmm. A little cluttered, but a lot of interesting stuff. How much of that is still preserved, and where is it?
All of the items were taken out of the building and put into storage. There were saying that it was cluttered is you're being very generous. There was a lot of junk that was in there due to the instability of the building with the leaks. There was a lot of material in there that was damaged due to the elements.
Got wet.
So some of it had to be thrown away. What the museum board wants to do moving forward is not have so much clutter in there, but have it strictly to the seven presidents that actually visited that building during their summer visits.
Can you name them all?
I can.
Go ahead.
All right. Well, we started off with President Grant and then moved on with President Garfield and then Chester Allen Arthur and William McKinley and Grover Cleveland and Woodrow Wilson and Benjamin Harrison.
Very good. So they all visited and went to church there at least once.
Yes.
You're describing all this work. I have a memory of going in there with Edgar in 1989. Mm-hmm. Building was not in great shape then. Almost 10 years passed before you guys got involved. How much money has it cost, and how much more do you got to raise?
A lot. And people ask me, when are we going to reopen? Well, my goal is, and I've only been president of the board for the past year and a half, but I said at the time my goal was to open up at least part of the interior of the building within 2 years, 2.5 years. And I still want to stick to that deadline.
Next spring.
So next spring, I hope by hook or crook that, you know, we have part of the building open.
We can at least go in and ring the bell.
Well, we can, and we have.
Yes.
But so far, there's been upwards of $2.5 million put into the building, the stabilization and the restoration, and we still have about another $1.5 million to go
before, for the interior now.
For the interior and the, you know, site planning and the exterior grading and sidewalks and those types of things.
You can't do that with a bake sale.
You can't do that with a bake sale.
No. So you either have to get a few people to write big checks, or you have to get state, federal government to write a few checks.
Well, trying to get money out of the state or federal government is virtually impossible, although we have been very fortunate that we've gotten it.
Yeah, you've done well.
Received federal
but it's all like matching, too. So
right.
It is matching.
They need checks so they can get the government money to match.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we have to wrap up the first half, and then we're going to come back and we'll talk more about the church and a little bit more about your programs.
Your seat cushion can be used to grant wishes.
Who said that? Hello?
Really can, you know.
You talking to me?
Sure am. Because the airline miles you earn and donate to Make-A-Wish can help send thousands of kids on their wish trips. So donate to Make-A-Wish today.
You really should, you know. You really should.
And give wishes wings, because wishes work wonders.
All right, we're back for the second half of the show. We've been talking about serving the building and a little bit about Long Branch history. You've got a project that's been ongoing for a couple of years.
Yeah, it's been going on for quite a while now. We've been doing plaques along the boardwalk. It was your idea originally, and I think you don't even remember this.
I remember being there when we did the one for that is now, it was in front of Greek to me.
It's still there.
It's still there, but it moved once, I think, if I remember.
No, it just got switched around because
okay.
It was facing, it was always supposed to be facing west so that when you walk by it, you could see it, but originally when it was placed, it was facing the other way,
and so we turned around. That was in honor of?
That was for the Mansion House Hotel, which is where Mary Lincoln visited. Mary Todd Lincoln came and stayed in Long Branch and actually put us on the map during the Civil War.
Okay.
All right. She came here. It was in every newspaper in the country, and after that, everybody wanted to come to Long Branch. So that's our first hotel, and we did that one down there in Pier Village. Now we're going to be putting up another one on Friday, finally. It actually came in just before Sandy. It's been sitting in my office ever since, waiting for the boardwalk to be finished. And so finally,
the boardwalk's beautiful.
It is gorgeous. It really is. It's beautiful. And this plaque is like, I can't wait to put up this plaque. It's got a whole montage of all the hotels that were on the corner of Brighton Avenue and the ocean. So it's got the Stetson Hotel, which is where Ulysses Grant first came.
Okay.
All right. And when that was torn, actually expanded and became the West End Hotel and Cottages, so that's all on the image. And then it became the Tackenassee Hotel. So all three of those hotels were on that site, and that's all on the plaque. And then down at the bottom, there's this great image of President Grant and General Sherman, and they're all dancing at a grand hop at the hotel. And your wife actually wrote the blurbs for it all.
And what is the, can you give us a paraphrase of the blurb, or is it just a brief description of what
it is? It's a brief description of the hotels, when they were built, what was there, and, you know, a little bit about who stayed at the hotels and everything.
How big is the plaque? That's a lot of information.
It is a lot, and it's a big plaque. It's about 3 foot by 3. It's big.
It's big. So
it's big.
It's going. It's,
2 foot by 2 foot it is.
And it's being mounted on a jetty stone.
It's on a large jetty stone, and it'll be at the end of Brighton and Ocean Avenue.
So when people watch this show, which will probably, it'll probably first pop up, be late December, January. They can go down and look at it.
They'll be able to go down there and look at it.
And we'll have some kind of historical, appropriate dedication ceremony when the weather turns
warm. Weather's better,
Jim and I will both show up in flip-flops.
Okay.
There you go.
All right, sounds good.
Well, part of what we're celebrating when we talk about Long Branch history is we were the nation's first seaside oceanfront resort. Mm-hmm. We were first. And before Newport, and there are reasons people came here. One is the ocean, and the other is there were places that didn't want the people who came to Long Branch.
No.
I mean, Elberon was settled by wealthy German Jews who were not well received in
Saratoga,
right. Probably Newport when the time came, but mm-hmm. We have a history of welcoming everybody in Long Branch.
Yeah, yes, and we had actors and actresses. We had a really large actor and actress colony before even the wealthy German Jews came. We had, you know, all of Broadway would come to Long Branch in the summer too because
summer
actors.
Broadway. I mean, yeah, New York Broadway.
New York Broadway, because they were not accepted as proper society either in the more refined hotels.
Well, you're a Long Branch native. You've been here your whole life. What got you interested in studying and learning the little intricacies of the hotels in Long Branch history?
Well, I always loved Long Branch history, and that's probably my old history teacher, Mrs. Neeson, over in Long Branch Junior High. But I always loved studying history. And I don't know, when I came back after college, at some point they were talking about starting, back then it was Harry Levin, and he talked about resurrecting a historical association, and I got involved. And then, I don't know, you go down the rabbit hole and just kept on falling.
But you've mentioned in the course of this relatively brief conversation, seven or eight hotels that offered, they were big time summer resorts.
Oh yeah, we were a major, we were like the number one seashore resort at one time.
And there was a reason the presidents came here. This was the place
to come.
Now, you grew up in Deal.
Yes, in the shadow of Elbron.
But I mean, you're not limited to just Long Branch history. You love the local history.
Oh, I love it. I also serve as the Deal historian, but I love Deal history. I love Elbron history, Long Branch history, the whole Jersey Shore history. But yes, Long Branch not only was the first great resort in America, but it's still a great resort.
Now, the Elbron section, which has no official boundary, I mean, some people might say Park, some might say Cedar Avenue to the north and to the Deal border. It's always been a little unique, you can't be a little unique. It's unique, it's different.
It's unique. And it was actually Lewis Brown, for whom it's named, Elbury Brown, mm-hmm. Elbron. He came down right after the New York City draft riots, and he was actually—
Civil War
draft riots. And he was actually chased out because he had an African-American servant with him who he brought to the polls with him, and a bunch of drunken Irishmen were not too thrilled that who Mr. Brown kept company with. So they threatened to hang both of them on his site of his Westchester property in New York.
He was a wealthy man.
He was a very wealthy man and a land developer. He actually came down to Long Branch during that fall and stayed here during the winter. And what he noticed was that, you know, prior to the Civil War, most of it was hotel life and grand balls and the things that originally attracted President
casinos.
Grant here. Gambling halls. They weren't called casinos at the time, but, you know, Phil Daly's gambling hall and Chamberlain's gambling hall.
Racetrack?
Racetrack in 1870. It was big time.
Mm-hmm.
Brown thought that he saw some stagnation, that there was a class of people that wanted to have an exclusive community but didn't want to be with 1,000 other people in the hotel. So he bought all the property from Tackenessie Lake to the Deal border, from the ocean to Norwood Avenue.
Big piece of property.
Big piece of property from the Woolleys, or partially from the Woolleys family, and started building cottages. From there,
define the word, what is a cottage? We have a 21st century view, but the late 1800s, some of those cottages were pretty—
Well, the house I grew up in, Deal, which is mimicked one of the Elbron cottages, was a four-story, 12-bedroom or 12-master-bedroom house with the bathroom in each room.
Mm-hmm.
That was a cottage, and that's what they were. That, you know, all of these, the Ocean Beach Club at the foot of Park Avenue, a massive three-story building, that was a summer cottage. And that's what Lewis Brown was building, and that was what all the people came. So not only the seven presidents and the actors and the wealthy German Jews, but, you know, the bankers and the Wall Street, and, you know, all of Wall Street was represented in Elbron. And it was amazing to see, you know, who was it? General Thomas Eckert, if you saw the movie Lincoln. And Lincoln hated the White House, and he was constantly going over to the telegraph office to hang out with the regular people. And he actually sat at General Thomas Eckert's desk when he penned the Gettysburg Address.
Which he never visited Long Branch, though. Abraham Lincoln.
No, his son, his wife did. All right. Mm-hmm. General Eckert lived where Mr. Jamal's house is now, in Elbron. Okay. There were actually, I think I've counted so far, seven generals from the Civil War that lived down Ocean Avenue.
Mm-hmm. How much independent research do the two of you do? You know, you hear one of these stories and you start digging. How?
Insane. People call up. We didn't have gray hair when we started.
No, people call up with a question to Long Branch, and somehow it always winds up somebody doing an email
to me. And they say, ask Beth.
Yeah,
ask Jim.
Right, ask Jim. And so you just start researching, and one thing leads to another and to another, and then you start to meet so many people in the historic community, so you start to know if you got a question, who you can ask, too, you know? And then they call and they ask you questions, and you all swap questions. And
for example, General Wilson, during the Civil War, the one who caught Jefferson Davis trying to escape dressed as a woman. You know, his relatives lived on Lincoln Avenue, right where the synagogue is. That was part of the Washington Wilson estate.
Okay. Now, you've been contacted by the Norman Mailer Society.
Another rabbit hole I went down. I mean, I knew Norman Mailer's parents were buried in our local, where your parents are buried.
Yes.
Over in Monmouth Field Cemetery in West Long Branch. So I knew that they were local, right?
Norman Mailer was born in Long Branch.
Norman Mailer was born in Long Branch. And then come to find out, Norman Mailer's grandfather was the first kosher butcher in Long Branch. That Schneider's butcher, where my mother always went to the butcher store, was...
No relation.
Yes. Not related to you.
No.
But was my mother's kosher butcher, was Norman Mailer's cousin, right? And that Norman Mailer's family, his uncle or aunt or whatever, his family ran the Scarborough Hotel, which used to be down at the end of Bath Avenue. And when his father, I believe, was an accountant, and they moved to New York, but every summer would come back and stay at the Scarborough. And as a young man, they would give him a room at the Scarborough, and he'd be typing away. And he actually wrote his first, like, published story here in Long Branch. And they want a plaque too down on the boardwalk, you know, for Norman Mailer. And
so
I think he should have one. Yes.
Okay, we'll figure it out. Well, thank you both very much for coming over. We learned something.
Absolutely. Thank you for having us.
We'll do it again sometime. Thank you.